Talk about one day chicken and the next day feathers. To date, the 2006 Champ Car Atlantic Championship chase has been a real roller coaster ride for two of the top drivers. Coming into round eight of the world's most prestigious open wheel development series, three men are separated by just a handful of points. The championship leader, Simone Pagenaud, has yet to capture a checkered flag. Now, at the start of the season, it looked as though German Andreas Wirth had the field's number. He grabbed commanding wins at both Long Beach and at Houston. Then a seeming drop in performance, followed by a catastrophic crash on the opening lap in Toronto, dragged this Forsythe Racing pilot to second in the standings. For Graham Rahal, his Atlantic experience is perhaps even more frustrating. After a win in Monterey, he appeared to be closing in on Wirth. Then this first lap incident put him out at Portland, and Graham tasted a different, more bitter fruit. Undeterred, he thundered twice to victory in Cleveland, setting a pace that at the time seemed unbeatable. But then, as with Wirth, came Toronto, and the fates again turned away. The opening lap was the culprit, and the best he could muster was 15th at the finish. So in spite of a combined 5 wins in 7 races, plus 5 poles, two of this season's brightest hopes are learning the hard way, nothing is guaranteed in racing. Indeed, one day can bring chicken, and the next day, feathers. Welcome to Yokohama presents the Champ Car Atlantic Championship powered by Mazda. Round 8 of a championship chase that has, as we've just seen, featured all manner of exploits and all manner of disasters. We're at City Center Airport in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada for the 8th race of the 2006 Champ Car Atlantic Championship season. I'm Rick Benjamin with Jan Bikas, Cameron Steele on pit road. Starting lineup today, Simone Pagenaud, who is the points leader for Derek Walker's team, and Rafael Matos will start alongside one another. Matos is the pole qualifier.
Rafael Matos has scored his second pole position of the championship, but there's one big difference. His first pole position was on a rolling start. Now we move to the standing start. Must be a great advantage being up front for a standing start.
Yeah, definitely. I believe it's a huge advantage because those guys, they can't draft me. So I think we have a really good race car, really consistent car. So hopefully we can win this one and hopefully keep the momentum going and win the rest of the race and try to win the championship.
Mottos for Sierra Sierra, bidding for his first win of the year. Second row, Andreas Wirth, who's been the championship leader. Graham Rahal, who is third in the point standings. Third row, Jonathan Bomarito in the 23 car. Richard Philippe, one of the Forsythe Indec Lair 7 machines. That's car number 33. Joe D'Agostino qualified 7th best for Newman Walks. James Hinchcliffe, who won at Portland, will start 8th here this afternoon.
James Hinchcliffe is our top starting Canadian here in the field in Edmonton. And, well, this is one of the faster tracks on the series. You're really digging it, aren't you?
Yeah, I'm having a lot of fun here in Edmonton. The track's really cool. And for a temporary circuit, it's got a ton of grip, a lot of fast corners. The car's working well. So we're starting 8th on the grid and 1 from 8th in Portland. So we'll see what we can do here in Edmonton.
In the 5th row here in Edmonton, Danilo Durrani, who was quick in the warm-up this morning, and Tim Bridgman out of England. 6th row, Ryan Lewis, who wrecked hard earlier this weekend, and Leo Maia in one of the Forsythe cars. 7th row, Colin Fleming out of California, his first start in the series, and he'll be teamed with Robbie Pecorari in the 28. He won at Toronto 2 weeks ago. Row number 8, Alan Sciuto, who struggled for pole star James Davison, the points leader's teammate in car number 5. The 9th row, Mexican David Martinez in the 4. Alex Spirofico in car number 10. He'll start in the 18th position. 10th row, rookie Carlos Mestrada in car number 8. And Steve Ott didn't qualify very well. The other Newman Walks entry, he was in that turn 1 wreck at Toronto that we saw a few moments ago. Justin Sofio and Alex Barron all the way back in 22nd. That's the 11th row. And in the 12th row here this weekend, Mike Forrest returning to the series, and he will start shotgun on the field in 23rd position. Getting ready to go green, Cameron Steele.
One thing you do want to do in the final warm-up in the morning is you want to be the fastest car out there. Andreas Wirth was just that, but his problems have continued from Toronto. One thing you don't want to do, you don't want to take the whole left side off the car. The Forsythe team had to do a quick repair on the car. This morning warm-up, he catches a little curb, snaps it around, backs it in, whammy, both wings left side. That's not a good thing to do for your team and not a good thing to do for your race car, but he is all set and ready to go, and he is on the grid, ready to get racing here in this standing start.
And, of course, the racetrack that they're going to be on is just under 2 miles. And the thing, Rick, it's so amazing. 5 flat-out corners. This is super high speed, high G, very physical. It should be awesome.
1.973 miles around here, and it'll be very, very racy, as Jan pointed out. Championship standings, top three within 18 points of one another. Pagenaud has taken over the top spot. Bomarito and Hinchcliffe very much in the thick of things as we check the top five with five races to go in the 2006 Atlantic Championship season. Martinez, Maya, Matos, and Shudo all within a whisker of one another. Durrani just four more points back in 10th position. A couple of onboard looks for you as we prepare for the standing start. Leo Maya in the Lair 7 Forsyth car. He'll line up in the 12th position today, and we will ride with Leonardo Maya as he hopes to get toward the podium today. We'll have onboards as well with Jonathan Bomarito, who starts sixth in car number 23, one of the Miracle Motorsports entries. Bomarito with high hopes here, certainly a strong contender, top 10 in the championship as we come in here this weekend. Bomarito, as a matter of fact, fourth right now as we prepare for the start. In Edmonton, Jan, second time the series has been here. Field ready to go.
Once you get the green flag at the back, there'll be two signboards that'll come up, and then we will see the lights. Obviously, as the reds extinguish, the greens come on. And this, as you heard Rafael Matos say, no drafting. It's all about the grip on the start.
Five and six wide, heading toward turn one.
Rafael Matos off like a rocket, but watch there in about third.
Pagenaud fighting for second spot. Andreas Wirth is right there.
Pagenaud got through.
They had to do major surgery on that car after Wirth whacked the wall a ton earlier today. Big traffic jam as they get away. One car did not get going. Leo Maya in the Lair 7 Forsyth car. They're going to have to take the front bodywork off to try to find out if electrical problems caused that. Now, he's in the middle of the straightaway. They've got a short period of time to get him out of the way, or they'll have to go yellow. Another look.
And if you would take the front cover off, typically that would mean
Tim Bridgman with a problem as well. No, that is still Maya.
And when you take the cover off, typically they're trying to get down to the pedal area. So, it could have been electrical, but there may be something in the pedal area they were trying to look at.
Full course caution. We will keep the field in check now. We haven't completed lap one as yet, and the yellow is being displayed here at City Center Airport. They call it Jag Flow Speedway this year in Edmonton. Temporary course built around the airport at a very, very fast place. And they've gotten Maya bump started, it appears. He'll be able to join the field, but he will be one lap down. So before we have the restart, let's get a quick timeout in. We'll be back with more of the Champ Car Atlantic Championship. Coverage of the eighth round of the 33rd season of the Champ Car Atlantic Championship is being brought to you today by Yokohama Tires. The uncompromising performance of Yokohama Tires, available at your local Yokohama Tire dealer. And by the all-new Mazda CX-7, the SUV you never saw coming. Back at City Center Airport in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, alongside Jan Bikas, I'm Rick Benjamin. Let's have a look at what happened to Leonardo Maya as the green came down. And we got the initial standing start.
Let's just listen, find out if it's electrical or clutch. The engine's still running, so it's not electrical, and that's why they would have taken the front cover off. Something happened with the clutch or the driveline. Cameron?
We're definitely speculating here, John Bruner, but is it a clutch problem with Leo's car?
No, it doesn't seem to be a problem with the clutch at all. It's something in the pedal and the stop. We shouldn't have to engage that far like you do on the start, so we're not positive what it was, but it's stuck, unstuck now. We'll investigate it after the race.
They're having a stuck clutch pedal. Seems to be the problem for Leo Maya.
Okay, I think what he was trying to say is it's not a clutch problem now, but that certainly was
sure.
The problem why he couldn't get off the line. So you don't need a clutch once you get going, just on the standing start.
So Maya, one lap down, he will restart at the tag end of the field here as we work on lap number three of 36. Matos is the restart leader, got a great drop on the field on the initial standing start, and he hauls him down into turn one.
Well, look at third place there.
D'Agostino trying to get to the inside of Richard Philippe.
Oh, and Rahal went wide. Graham Rahal is slipping back in the field.
Rahal in that Gale, car number 18, the three wins earlier, qualified third quick. He was quick in a couple of sessions here, but has not had a good start to this event.
There he is in the center of the screen in the yellowish-orange Gale machine. Sandwiched between, looks like, Bomarito and one of the four side entries, which would be Hinchcliffe.
Hinchcliffe in car number three, who snuck through the melee at Portland to grab a victory several weeks ago, back in the month of June. There he is, behind his teammate Andreas Wirth, who whacked the wall so hard this morning in the warm-up.
Danilo Durrani in the bright yellow car. You saw him also take a spot, and now he's getting battled back on the outside.
Tim Bridgman right there, and Bob Marino right there as well, fighting with Durrani for position. So you've got
Someone hit the wall.
One car in the wall hard. You can see that car slowing down.
Oh, it's Hinchcliffe.
Hinchcliffe looks like he knocked the
wheel
off. James Hinchcliffe in the Imexus car, having trouble getting that car wowed down. Boy, from chicken salad to chicken feathers for James Hinchcliffe after a pretty good qualifying.
Oh, both the team cars for Gellis Racing are duking it out. And they're trying to make a move on Graham Rahal. And he's in trouble.
Rahal through the grass.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Another racetrack. That's Ryan Lewis, actually, in car number 30.
That's his teammate.
As the two Western Union Gellis cars roll through, Pecorari, the winner at Toronto a couple of weeks ago.
And here comes Ott. That's the bright green roll hoop on the red and white car. Steve Ott brushed the wall in qualifying. He should be fast.
From 20th to 13th already, and we've only run one lap under green. And there's Alex Barron's teammate Alan Sciutto in car number 12, the Polestar Sealy Posturepedic entry. There's Lewis in the 30, Ott in the 35. Now they're back in 10th and 11th. A lot to talk about here in the first few laps as we are green. All this began when James Hinchcliffe got wide out of the final corner, out of turn 12, running to the little 13-14 chicane. Here it is.
First, this is Hinchcliffe getting wide. Kablamo, huge hit. And that was Graham Rahal taking avoiding action. Danilo Durrani coming through. Then this move, this of course is Rahal's teammate. Lewis tries to go 2x2, can't do it. Shortcuts. That will not be a penalty because he didn't obviously gain position. That was a tight one.
Don't know if we'll be able to show it to you. Hopefully we can. Lewis wrecked that car a ton earlier this weekend. And they have worked hard in the MyJack Conquest squad. And it looks like he's in trouble again. That is Lewis again off track. Visor up. He's okay.
A bent tie rod. Look just to the left of the number 30. That is supposed to be straight. And that is bent. So he's definitely on the way. And look at that Hinchcliffe machine. It's just thrashed.
James Hinchcliffe done for the day, no doubt. All the front suspension pieces on the left side broken, and the Forsyth team will have to get to work. Here comes Lewis. Now the MyJack Conquest bunch will have their work cut out for him. He can drive the car, but pieces will have to be changed. Here's another look.
Oh, that is the very same place that he had shortcut previously. Look at the corner workers diving for cover, which is a smart move. Then they get the yellow out. But he has had a tough weekend. Obviously, that car is severely damaged, but not nearly as bad as you said, Rick, as that huge shunt that he had, I believe, on opening day.
Lewis crabbing that car around the racetrack slowly to the MyJack Conquest team's pit area. Meantime, the Gellis team running nose to tail here. Pecorari in the 28, right at the moment, running behind his brand new teammate. Just joined the team this week, Colin Fleming from North Hills, California.
And Colin Fleming comes from European Racing, says this has been a big transition for him, but he's got to be pleased to be ahead of his teammate at the moment.
They are 10th and 11th. The work going on in the Forsyth pit area. Hinchcliffe's car behind, well, not behind the wall yet, but you can pretty much count that Hinchcliffe, fifth in the championship, will not run any more laps here this afternoon in Edmonton. Another look.
Now, there's a little bit of a touch of the curb, and then here you can just tell the trajectory is wrong. He's out of the groove. Kablamo, the pieces come off, and watch Graham Rahal just behind makes very quick avoiding action.
Yeah, and we've seen this sort of thing all weekend, not just in the Atlantic Series, but in the Champ Car World Series as well. Grip seems to be at a real premium here.
Well, the thing is, it's a very high grip racetrack, so all of a sudden, if you get off the high grip portion, it does get super slick in a hurry.
Rafael Matos loving things at the moment. He is your leader. Put the sixth car on pole here this weekend, gunning for his first career Champ Car Atlantic Series win. Seven laps of 36 are complete. The ProWorks Sierra machine is at the top of the leaderboard. The points leader, Pagano, in front of Philippe and D'Agostino. We'll be back. Welcome back to Jag Flow Speedway at City Center Airport. We're in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, as Yokohama presents the Champ Car Atlantic Championship powered by Mazda with Jan Beekhuis, Seinberg Benjamin, Cameron Steele is on pit road. Rafael Matos has led from the start after putting the sixth car, the Sierra machine, on the pole. But here comes the points leader, Simone Pagenaud, reeling him in now, Jan, and he's getting closer every time around.
Think about the fact that Simone Pagenaud drives for Team Australia. Team Australia just finished the Champ Car race, and they can share engineering information. It looks to me as though Rafael Matos was just like a lightning bolt at the start of the race, but now maybe the track is not what to his liking, and Simone Pagenaud, to me, looks extremely racy and now just picking his time.
Joe D'Agostino is third in the Newman Walks 34. Now, he started seventh. He got a good start as well. It was Matos who took off like a shot out of a cannon. He opened up a huge lead down into turn one from the standing start. But Pagenaud, now things have settled down a little. And Pagenaud slowly chopping into that advantage. Half a second last time by.
Simone Pagenaud is a bit like his proto. He's the protege, of course, of Sebastian Bourdais. And they have a similarity in they run consistently and they run smooth and they're easy on the tires. And you can watch Rafael Matos in the red machine. You can see more attitude. You can see more working of the car. And I think that Simone Pagenaud is saving it and it's showing a lot of speed.
Keeping the car straight generally is the faster way around.
Well, you can be fast by slipping and sliding, but you won't be good at the end of the race.
Yeah.
So it's a case where you do need to save the tires. Yokohamas are very strong, but you don't want to overuse them.
There is Pagenaud going by. Fourth spot belongs to Andreas Wirth in that Indec Forsythe 37 car. Now, Wirth won the first two races of the season. He was the championship leader. He's struggled of late. He rides fourth right now after qualifying that car in the fourth position. What a Herculean job they put in, that team put in.
Whoa.
To take care of him.
That's Philippe.
Richard Philippe in the 33 car was up in the top three. So he's given that spot up now. Joe D'Agostino getting by. Moving to third. Philippe gets shuffled back to sixth. Wirth moves to fourth with that incident. There's Graham Rahal in the 18. He is fifth now in that Gale machine. Three wins on the season for young Mr. Rahal.
And you could tell from that replay, if you wanted a good replay of what the G-force is here, that was a low angle where you saw him come across. And the moment that something goes wrong, you get an idea how fast these guys are hanging the corners. It's awesome.
Rahal trying to chop into the advantage held by Andreas Wirth. These are two of the championship contenders coming in today.
And just watch from this angle. You can just see the cars move and how it's gripping. Look what happens the moment you just get a little bit off of that high grip surface. It's like you hit water, oil, ice, you name it. It's unbelievable. You have to keep the car right in the groove. And when you do, it feels fantastic.
Working the 11th lap of 36 today. In the eighth race of the Champ Car Atlantic Championship for 2006, there is Wirth in that Indec Forsythe car, second by 9 points behind Simone Pagenaud. Track temperature, we're told, about 117 degrees at this point. So it is maybe the hottest day of the season so far. Pretty hot at Monterrey, Mexico early in the year as well. I would say about the same, probably. Not as humid here, Jan, as what we had in Mexico.
But remember that the Atlantic boys, and certainly Graham Rahal, we got to keep an eye on this. He's really starting to push Andreas Wirth. But they normally run early in the day. They get the bit of the cooler day. This particular circuit in Edmonton just gets hotter and hotter as the day goes on. And they'll be feeling it by the end.
Yeah, this race started at about 2 o'clock local time, 4 o'clock Eastern on this Sunday afternoon. Wirth in the 37, runs fourth. Fifth spot belongs to Graham Rahal in that Gale car number 18.
And as the track temperature heats up, Graham Rahal feels that that's to his advantage. He feels that the strength of the team, and, you know, he wasn't very strong off that corner. I don't like how he came off that corner. He may have a problem. He was right behind Wirth and just didn't have any zip coming off that corner like he was missing a gear or something.
Now there's the ProWorks Sierra car, Rafael Matos. He is the race leader. He's led all the way so far. We're a third of the way home in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. Back with more of the Atlantic Championship. Welcome back to the Champ Car Atlantic Championship in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, City Center Airport. The eighth race of the 2006 season. I'm Rick Benjamin with Jan Mikas and Cameron Steele. Wednesday night on Speed Payback. Celebrities and superstars give the shock of a lifetime. A thank you to someone who made a difference in their lives. Giving away a custom ride has never felt so good. That was the Ultimate Payback. It's Wednesday at 10 Eastern here on Speed. Working lap number 15, riding with Jonathan Bomarito. Bomarito sits eighth in that Miracle Motorsports car number 23.
Down from turn 9 to turn 10, 140 miles an hour. And this one's about 87 miles an hour at the apex, all high speed, high G corners, 125 here. Then down about 80 miles an hour at the slowest point here. This is the one you really want to get off well to get a good drive. as we you can really get a sense of how someone's hooked up, how they come off turn 12.
Well, let's reset the field for you. Rafael Matos has led all the way now. First 15 laps have gone in his favor. Simone Pagenaud about 6/10 back as we watch Bomarito continuing to run in 8th position. Third belongs to Joe D'Agostino. And the fight for 7th between Durrani, who runs there in car number 1, and Bomarito. Bomarito chopping it down briefly, but now Durrani started to pull away just a little bit again. Danilo Durrani in that yellow car number 1 sits in 7th position. Andreas Wirth is 4th, Graham Rahal 5th, and Richard Philippe, after a spin a few moments ago, has fallen back to 6th in car number 33, one of the 4-car Forsythe Index super teammates. There's Philippe, younger brother of Nelson Philippe in the Champ Car World Series, who marked his 20th birthday here at Edmonton this weekend. Richard Philippe about 10.9 seconds behind the leaders.
And I think that's why we saw the seesaw in the interval, was because there's 3 cars involved.
A lot of things have been happening here in Edmonton today. Have a look at this a few laps ago. This is Justin Sofio and Alex Barron.
Sofio comes to the inside. Alex Barron gives him some room, but eventually he has to turn in. So Sofio punts Alex Barron. He gets the car turned around. He continues. Sofio had to hit pit road, but they gave him a black flag penalty for avoidable contact. We've seen that throughout the season. Race director Bo Barfield has said to each of the competitors that it is not our aim to ruin your day. We're not trying to pull you in and ruin your day at the racetrack. But if you come in and you punt someone and it's avoidable, it's just, it's in the rule book. You're going to have to make a drive-through.
Reasonable rule, to be sure, as we ride with Jonathan Bomarito, currently in 8th position. Third car in that skirmish that took out Alex Barron, Justin Sofio a few moments ago, was the 8 car, Carlos Mastretta, out of Mexico. And Mastretta stays clean. He continues to run. He is in 15th right now, as Barron has gotten back on the track, and he runs along in 19th position. Meantime, there's car number 35, Steve Ott. I know you've spoken to him, Jan, a couple of times. Good run for Mr. Ott in his second start for Newman Walk. Started deep in the field. He's come up to 11th. He's been the big mover so far here today. Ott lined up in 20th when we took the green.
Yeah, but the car just had a big, just stepped out there. And I think that Colin Fleming, who's coming up behind him, certainly to me appears as though he's got quite a bit more speed and car under him. Colin Fleming, this is a great debut. When you come from Europe and you're driving higher horsepower, faster essentially cars, and he was a guy who was tainted as the man who may become a Friday Formula One test driver.
Yeah.
Now this is a big transition to go to the Atlantic. It takes a different driving style.
Out of the North Hills, California area, Colin Fleming making his first start in the Champ Car Atlantic Championship, and he'll be in that car for the balance of the season as Richard Philippe blasts by. Richard Philippe continuing to run in 6th. His teammate Andreas Wirth, 4th now in the Wirth Solar Forsythe Index car number 37. This is Philippe in front of Danilo Durrani in that yellow car number 1, running 6th and 7th as we come up to halfway. Next time by, they'll see the crossed flags.
And Richard Philippe has certainly had a lot of speed. We saw his pretty dramatic spin. We had a couple replays of that. But he's young, and he's got a lot of talent, and that's what the series is all about, is refining it. Up front, Simone Pagenaud still keeping. I'm surprised that Pagenaud hasn't pushed even farther, but he may be waiting for his opportunity later on.
Graham Rahal in the 18 car. The Gale machine continues to run in 4th. Andreas Wirth right behind him in 5th.
And that's been a change, so he has worked his way by.
Andreas Wirth in 5th by about half a second is the gap last time by. They lap by Justin Sofio's car, and Wirth off the racetrack. Right rear tire on the dirt there. And Wirth backs off a little bit there, and he'll have to gather himself back up. Take a look back at Andreas Wirth at Long Beach. He spanked the field, led every lap at Long Beach back in April, opening up the season with a win. Then at Houston, he was the dominant player again, 2 for 2. In Toronto, well, he got caught up in this incident in turn 1. A couple of bits of contact there cost him a good chance at a good finish. Wirth in the championship fight, 2nd right now, 9 points behind Simone Pagenaud coming into today's action. Wirth back on the button, continues to run 5th, but lost considerable ground to Graham Rahal in that exchange a few moments ago. Matos is your leader, Pagenaud less than a second back in 2nd spot. Joe D'Agostino in front of Rahal and Wirth. We are halfway home in Alberta. Welcome back to the Champ Car Atlantic Championship, the Grand Prix of Edmonton, 8th race of 2006. We're at City Center Airport in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. Simone Pagenaud in the Team Australia car, still trying to track down Rafael Matos for the race lead. Matos with about a half second advantage, 16 laps to go this afternoon. Matos has led from the start, got a great start. From the standing start on the main straightaway moments ago, our Mazda Power Play. Jan with a look at Gelis Racing.
Gelis Racing got their breakthrough victory in Toronto in the capable hands of Robbie Pecoraro. But on pit road, talking to team owner Bob Gelis, the cat was let out of the bag. And that is all along, Bob, you've known you're going to move to Champ Car?
Yeah, we've had a three-year vision to move to Champ Car. It's an exciting series this year with the new car coming out for 07. We're really excited to be coming on board. And to that end, we've added a driver for the balance of the season. Colin Fleming is with us for the last five races.
So should we infer from that that Colin Fleming might be the Champ Car driver of the future?
Well, he didn't name the drivers. He just said the team's going there.
Yeah.
But, you know, right after that interview, I turned to Colin. I said, well, we've now got him to say it twice on television, so you're looking good.
Yeah.
And he says, okay, keep it up. Now I just got to figure out how to get my way in that seat. But they're very high on both their drivers.
From North Hills, California, he would be a good addition to the Champ Car World Series, no question. Meantime, this is a battle for position. Graham Rahal has gotten by the car of Joe D'Agostino. So Rahal the third now. Let's have a look at the pass.
D'Agostino gets off the corner. Fairly good, but it's a long enough straightaway on the approach to turn number one. Oh, an aggressive move by Graham Rahal. Some inside front lockup. Perfectly done. D'Agostino's fighting for it, but doesn't have enough for Rahal. Just a little bit of smoke. Showing, I mean, that just gives you, when you turn and brake at that kind of force, something's got to give, and that was beautifully done. And I was starting to say earlier that Graham Rahal thinks that the strength of this team is consistency and speed at the end of the race, and again, he's showing it.
What I liked about that move, not only did he make the pass, but he forced D'Agostino to be loose off the next corner, so he gave himself some gap. He pulled away pretty quickly because of that. Now D'Agostino in the clutches, perhaps, of Andreas Wirth. This could be a battle for fourth.
And once you start to lose some momentum, and there's no question that Joe D'Agostino is driving this car as hard as he possibly can, but he's losing some of the handling. Just, oh, he's even loose on the entry to the corners. Now, this Newman Walks entry, of course, that is Paul Newman and Eddie Walks who have formed this team. And Eddie Walks told me, hey, I've been racing all my life. I've owned businesses. I thought it'd be just a cinch, put the right people together. And he says, it is way harder than I thought it was going to be.
Extremely tight, extremely competitive with these brand new Champ Car Atlantic
chassis. There he comes.
Wirth to the inside. He'll make the pass. Shuffle D'Agostino back to fifth. So Andreas Wirth, second in the championship coming in this weekend, makes the pass and gets into fourth position. 13 laps to go. Cameron.
I'm here with James Hinchcliffe, who before the race we talked about, we'll review. You like the high-speed track here. What happened?
Well, I went out in a low-speed corner, Cameron. It was unfortunate. We got not a great start, but then made up two spots when Bomarito and Durrani went off there, and then right off the restart got Rahal into one, and you know, had a pretty good car, a little bit of an understeer, and then just on the first flying lap there, coming through 11 and 12, got on the power nice and early. It was a really slick corner, and I got a little bit of understeer, and as soon as I went 6 inches offline with all the Champ Car marbles out there, I was along for the ride. It's the first time we've run after the Champ Car, so just, you know, no room for error with the amount of marbles that were on the track, and basically driver ran out of talent halfway through corner 12.
Well, we hate when you run out of talent. You have to wait for your next win at the next round.
You don't often hear a young driver admit he ran out of talent. I like the way James Hinchcliffe put that.
Yeah, he just has a great demeanor when you talk to him. He's excitable. He's a jokester, but he gets the job done in the car. And, you know, this series is about you'd rather make your mistakes here than you would other places. And, you know, get it out of your system. It's a development series. Not that everyone isn't giving it their all, but this is the place where you make mistakes at a little lower speed. Keep yourself in one piece.
Yeah, the risk level isn't quite as high. Rafael Matos not taking many risks, none that were not worth taking, certainly. Good jump on the start has paid off. Matos has led all the way. Coming up, close to 10 to go at Edmonton. Danilo Durrani runs 7th. The two-thirds point of the 2006 Champ Car Atlantic Championship season. We're at City Center Airport in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. And coming up on Speed Monday night, inside Nextel Cup, you've seen the racing action through the fence. See what it looked like to the driver through the windshield. Dave Despain and the biggest stars in NASCAR break down all this weekend's Cup action inside Nextel Cup, Monday at 8 Eastern, 10 Pacific. On Speed, Ivrik Benjamin, Jan Beekes alongside, Cameron Steele on pit road, riding here with Jonathan Bomarito eighth position for Bomarito. He qualified pretty well here this weekend in sixth. He's backpedaled a couple of spots. Just doesn't seem to have the speed today. Rafael Matos, though, has had no such issues, Jan. Laps winding down, coming up 10 to go this time by. Pagenaud in second has gotten close a couple of times and then has fallen back. Now, is he saving something for the last few laps?
I thought at first it's Simone Pagenaud, and I said that I thought he had more than Rafael Matos, but it appears as though the person who was saving something was Rafael, that he is able to stay consistent. Now, not to say that Simone Pagenaud doesn't have something, but it is definitely harder work. At one time, visibly, you could see that Simone had something in the bag. Now, I think he's just pushing with everything he's got left.
In the Aussie Vineyards, car number 15 for Walker Racing. Derek Walker and Craig Gore, you know the story. They've started this Atlantic program as a development effort. They've got a lot going on. We've got a very successful young driver from Australia and the NASCAR Craftsman Trucks, Marcos Ambrose, who came over at the start of the season, finished third in a Truck Series event just a couple of weeks ago. And, of course, they have Alex Tagliani and Will Power, who is getting better week by week in the Champ Car World Series. And they are the team's two lead drivers right now. But Pagenaud with a lot going for him here.
Well, you know what else he has going for him? He has the championship lead, and Rafael Matos is not one of those in the fight. But talk about a fight. Danilo Durrani as well as Philippe.
Durrani in car number one, running seventh. And he has gotten by Richard Philippe for sixth. So Philippe drops back a spot. That's Bomarito in eighth. So Richard Philippe struggling a bit. Remember, he spun earlier after qualifying very well. Philippe started fifth here today. Got up to third early. Now here comes Philippe back on the inside in turn one.
He doesn't have position. He looked to the inside, but he could possibly get him on the exit, because what happened, though, is Danilo Durrani gave him room. He saw him come and looked in the mirrors and gave him room, got out in those marbles that James Hinchcliffe told us about, and the rest is history.
Richard Philippe with a nice pass back on Danilo Durrani, so put Philippe back sixth now. With nine laps remaining here at City Center aboard in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. One more look.
It's a case where in the entry of the corner, Danilo Durrani, you can see a little bit of a wiggle there. It's because he left some extra room and was wise at the time, but got offline and lost the momentum.
Philippe up over the curb, but he didn't back off.
Stayed with it, and it's all about momentum.
So Richard Philippe retakes sixth from Danilo Durrani. Durrani, one of the championship contenders as well, starting the day. Durrani 10th in points, but within hailing distance of the leaders. Rafael Matos is out in front. He has led all the way with eight to go.
And I think what's happened, Rick, is I think that Simone Pagenaud is happy with second. He'll get points, and Matos is not a championship contender yet.
Rafael Matos dominant here at Edmonton. It's a beautiful weekend for racing, a little on the warm side. Plenty of incentive to head to the water after racing is complete. Ray Hall sits third. Trouble in Edmonton. Race leader Rafael Matos, something broke on the car. We could see parts trailing. He's got a left front tire down as the laps wind down. We were all set to hand him the trophy on Bikas, but he's gotten in trouble.
You can tell that there's damage up on the front of the car. We don't know if that happened prior to the spin or after. I was just saying that I thought that Simone Pagenaud kind of figured, you know what, he's not near me in the points. Let's just let him have this win. We'd love to have second place. And then all of a sudden, he's spinning like a top.
Broken race car for Rafael Matos. One more look.
Everything looks okay at this stage. And, you would say that the car was fine until it got rearranged on the concrete wall. Rafael Matos, that is crushing. The race was his. And we saw the spin afterwards, but obviously it was already heavily damaged.
Turn 12 was the place where that happened. That's a big sweeper, essentially.
And that was a change for the lead right there. Simone Pagenaud just zipped by him. And unfortunately, as the team just can't believe it, their man Rafael Matos, there's no other thing to say that unfortunately he threw that one away.
Matos with a comfortable lead. He had led all the way.
This is after the car was damaged against the wall. He was just trying to see if he could continue. But you can certainly tell at this point, heavy damage from the previous corner where he got heavy into the wall.
Well, you make those two right-hand corners at 11 and 12.
Offline. There you go.
Yeah. Just got up in the gray and couldn't keep the car down.
Parts trailing behind. And having that's got to be the toughest thing as a driver. It's hard enough to win these races, but when it's within sight and the guy behind you, in my view, had essentially said, okay, Rafael, this is your race, just one little lapse of concentration and kablamo.
Chicken salad to chicken feathers for Rafael Matos, and he is out of the race after leading the first 27, 28 laps here today. Simone Pagenaud cashes in. He takes over. Pagenaud with a 10-second lead over Graham Rahal. So the championship leader stands to gain huge ground here in Edmonton. One more look at what happened to Matos.
And you can see he was not under pressure. And this is exactly what happened to James Hinchcliffe. James had said there were marbles on the outside of the racetrack. And, of course, Rafael Matos is still pushing, but he had a big lead. Got out in the gray, as we call it. Next stop, concrete barrier.
So the Sierra Pro Works team, they'll have to load up the sixth car and get it fixed quickly because we have back-to-back races. Next week, San Jose, California on the street circuit there. Matos will get another opportunity in just a few days, and maybe that's the best news of all for him and for that team. Pagenaud, meantime, he's got his hands full. Well, that's not Graham Rahal. Saw the yellow car. I thought that was Rahal. I thought, wait a minute, he was 10 seconds behind a moment ago. That couldn't possibly be. He has laps by.
Yeah.
He has lapped by Justin Sofio back there. So Pagenaud at the moment in very good shape. Rahal about 11 seconds behind last time by with five laps to go. Now, Pagenaud started the race with a 9-point lead over Andreas Wirth, who runs third. So if we stay the way we are the last few laps, Pagenaud will add to his margin with four races to go. We'll race in San Jose, Denver, Montreal, and the season will close in September at Road America. Matos obviously upset with what happened, upset with himself. Have a look at how the crew responded to all this.
David Empringham. And it's just a case where, you know, what can you say?
No.
They thought they had it. I mean, they could tell, as we could tell, that Simone was going to let him go.
And if you're David Empringham, that has to be doubly painful because you're the driver coach for Rafael Matos.
Absolutely. And just a tough break for Sierra Serra.
Pagenaud is your leader. Handful of laps to go here in Edmonton. Four to go, as a matter of fact. Rahal and Wirth hoping for podium finishes. We'll be back. Welcome back to Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, City Center Airport. The Champ Car Atlantic Championship. Yokohama presents the Champ Car Atlantic Championship, powered by Mazda. I'm Rick Benjamin with Jan Vikas and Cameron Steele. Tuesdays on Speed Superbikes. Step into the world of high revving, tire shredding, wheel standing sport bikes. We'll go inside and on the road like you've never seen before. Superbikes Tuesday night at 9 Eastern, only here on Speed. Riding with Jonathan Bomarito, who cashes in. He moves up a spot with Matos' retirement. He's shown seventh. And the eight car is in the wall as well. That is Carlos Mastretta. Now, he was 13th. He had a pretty good day going until that. He ran out of racetrack down at the end of the front stretch in the Brooks car. So Mastretta with the car apparently dead stick down there. And Pagenaud continues to run at the front. He'll get the two-lap-to-go sign this time by. 10.5 seconds the lead over Graham Rahal.
And sees nothing in the mirror. That's the greatest thing.
Yeah.
L2, when you look in the mirror, and there's nobody home. Cameron?
Well, Rafael, I think you thought you might have been safe out here in the grass from the reporters, but we've caught up to you. What happened out there in turn 12?
It was pushing to the limit. Simone was putting some good laps, and we were pretty equal. I just was trying to keep the same gap and bring the car to the victory, you know. Unfortunately, I made a little mistake, and that cost me the race. What happened?
Definitely a disappointed Matos. He'll have to wait in San Jose for his first win on the series.
And, yeah, this, of course, like Cleveland, it's a flat racetrack, maybe a little off camber in places. Looked like he missed the apex only by 6 or 8 inches. Is that the margin here at a place like this?
Yes, it's only a matter of inches. And you heard him say that he was trying to keep the pressure up because he was concerned about Simone's times. But remember, there's a lag from what the teams tell you. He now just looks at what could have been. He knows that instead of Simone Pagenaud, everyone watching running around the lead, that could have been him.
White flag for Simone Pagenaud. One to go here in Edmonton. Now, is that a case where Matos doesn't want to walk back to pit road to face the team quite yet?
Well, they're all together. They're a team. And they all know that he was pushing, and they may have asked him to push. But my feeling was that Simone had just let him go, and he didn't need to push that hard. But he gets his information on the pit board a lap later and thought he had to push.
Watching Simone Pagenaud, who cashes in big. Take a look at the lap times for Pagenaud, a little bit quicker as the fuel load has lightened. His best lap recently there, back in lap 32, but he's taken a tenth or so off the last several times. Derek Walker watching Simone Pagenaud from France, protege of Sebastian Bourdais, who helped Pagenaud hook up with Walker Racing and get this ride in the Champ Car Atlantic Championship. Pagenaud on his way to the first victory of the season for Walker Racing in the Atlantic Championship fight. Final couple of corners. He's got to make that last right-left chicane to the front stretch. And Simone Pagenaud will add to his championship lead here in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada, with his first win of 2006. Pagenaud is your winner. Big round of applause on pit road from Team Australia.
And some possible donuts in the offering, one-handed.
Pagenaud lights him up to the delight of the big crowd here in Edmonton. Canadian fans, of course, love their motorsports, and they love this Atlantic Championship. And they have thoroughly enjoyed all the action all weekend long. Pagenaud waving to the fans, celebrating his first win. He adds to his lead two-thirds of the way through the Champ Car Atlantic Championship season. Ray Hall finishes second. Worth is third. Richard Philippe and Danilo Durrani, the rest of the top five. We will come back, talk to the winner, and tie up all the storylines at the Champ Car Atlantic Championship in Edmonton in just a moment. Coverage of the eighth round of the 33rd season of the Champ Car Atlantic Championship is being brought to you by the all-new Mazda CX-7, the SUV you never saw coming. And by Yokohama Tires, the uncompromising performance of Yokohama Tires, available at your local Yokohama Tire dealer. Big crowd on hand for the Champ Car Atlantic Championship in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. They saw quite a battle today between Rafael Matos and Simone Pagenaud, who wins his first of the season. Cameron Steele.
Well, you can see the confetti flying and the checker flag is waving. Simone Pagenaud, his fourth podium on the season, and it's finally the one you want, the number one spot. Congratulations.
Yeah. That was fantastic race. Rafael was very quick, but I know my car was quicker. I have the best car on the field today. I just wanted to manage my tires and try to put him some pressure. And fortunately, he did a mistake. I wasn't expecting that he was doing one, but I'm lucky today and take my first win. It's very good for the team. We worked so hard. I thank them so much. Thank you.
I know your mom, dad, and girlfriend are here, and that's very exciting. But what did you think when you saw Matos off and hit the wall?
I said myself, you know, I'm so lucky. It's my year. I have to do it now. Keep pressure, keep going, and I tried to do the fastest lap again at the end, but tires decreased a little bit because it's so hot, you know, but the car was fantastic.
Well, a big win for Simone Pagenaud. Moving forward in the points, he extends his lead.
He does indeed, because Graham Rahal and Andreas Wirth come home behind Pagenaud here today. Rahal ends up second, Wirth third. Richard Philippe battles back to fourth in front of Danilo Durrani. Jonathan Bomarito comes home sixth with Joe D'Agostino, who fought back to seventh. Bridgman, Colin Fleming in his first start, and the Toronto winner Robbie Pecorari rounding out the top ten. But Pagenaud with a big 10-second victory. Alan Sciuto, David Martinez, James Davison, Mike Forrest, who started last, came to 14th in front of Alex Barron. Alex Barifico, Leo Maia, who had problems at the start. Carlos Mastretta was in the wall. Ryan Lewis was fast, but had problems as well. And James Hinchcliffe, the Portland winner, was the first car out. Back to Cameron.
Well, Graham, we thought maybe the good luck charm, your dad on the pit board, might do it for you today, but second place, not a bad way to go.
No, you know, in a championship race, we just got to score all the points we can. And you know, I mean, we struggled a bit this weekend, but I got to give it to my guys, because when it really came down to it, we put together a pretty good race car. And you know, we just took the points we could get. And when everybody else messed up, we took advantage of it, and here we are.
With only a few rounds left to go, do you find it surprising at all that the three guys that are the players in the points are right here on the podium?
No. I mean, I figure that's going to happen. It's going to be very, very tough to close down the gap now. We've got to have the other two having some bad races, to be honest. Especially Pagenaud, you know, he's always been strong, but not this strong. So we'll get him at San Jose.
We'll see if he can do it.
Now Graham Rahal in the title fight till the end, it appears. Third in points coming in. He finishes second here today. Andreas Wirth finishes third. Wirth now 18 points out of the championship lead. Pagano builds the lead to 18. Rahal right there at third. Bomarito still with an outside shot, I think.
I think Jonathan is fast, and he's particularly good on street circuits, so there's something left for Bomarito.
Great crowd all weekend long, of course, here in Edmonton. The fans love this sport, and they love this event. Next up for the Atlantic, San Jose, the street course. You'll see our coverage Saturday, August the 5th, right here on Speed. All the motorsports news you need at speedtv.com. For Jan Beekes and Cameron Steele, I'm Rick Benjamin, congratulating our winner.